Good evening, all teachers and Dharma friends. Let's begin tonight's teaching by generating bodhicitta.
那么菩提心呢，我们这几天每天都在讲菩提心啊，然后呢，每天都在提醒大家发菩提心啊，因为这个菩提心就是我们大乘佛教的啊精华，大乘佛教的基础。如果没有菩提心，那么根本就不叫大乘佛教。
For the past several evenings, I've been reminding everybody every evening about the importance of generating bodhicitta. And the reason this is because bodhicitta is the essence and the foundation of the greater vehicle.
所以我们不管是藏传佛教还是汉传佛教，凡是大乘佛教都特别特别的重视这个菩提心。
Both the Chinese tradition and the Tibetan tradition alike very much emphasize the importance of bodhicitta.
大家为什么这么重视这个菩提心呢？因为菩提心，有菩提心，那么我们的烧香拜佛，包括烧香拜佛、诵经磕头、文思修心，这些都成为大乘佛教。如果 没有菩提心的话，那我们啊，表面上弘法利生、利益众生啊、帮助众生等等啊，做得再好再好，那么这些都只能叫做行善啊，做好事，但是不叫大乘佛教。
And the reason the Mahayana tradition values bodhicitta so much is that with this as our basic motivation, then all of our dharmic conduct, from making incense offerings right through to all kinds of dharmic practice we might engage in, is transformed into dharmic conduct that is in accordance with the aspiration of the Mahayana tradition. On the other hand, if we lack bodhicitta, then even the grandest kinds of dharmic activity, from benefiting beings and engaging in work to spread the Dharma, without bodhicitta, then we can only consider this kind of work to be positive, meritorious conduct.
啊，所以我们要提醒大家啊，修菩提心。嗯，啊，那么菩提心是什么呢？简单的说啊，就是我们为了天下所有的众生的解脱啊而。啊，法师成佛，为了成佛，我们今天啊听课啊这样子的这个发心，就叫做菩提心。
So the aspiration of bodhicitta entails the aspiration to attain Buddhahood in order to assist in the liberation of all beings, and it's for this purpose that we tonight are listening to this teaching.
啊，所以我们首先要发菩提心，但是这个发菩提心呢，啊，就是需要修啊，需要用专门的去修，才能够发标准的菩提心。啊，如果我们没有认真的、专门的去修菩提心的话，那么这个菩提心呢，也就是只能说这是一个不太标准的啊，比较这个相似的菩提心，不是真正的菩提心。
So it's important that we all cultivate bodhicitta. However, in order to cultivate bodhicitta in a genuine way, it's very necessary that we actually apply ourselves to the practice of bodhicitta. Without engaging in the practice of bodhicitta, then our aspiration of bodhicitta is really only an approximation.
好，发了菩提心以后呢，我们就讲今天的这个课啊。那今天的课就是禅定啊，是我们佛教里面呢比较高端的课程。
So having generated an aspiration of bodhicitta, we're going to move on to the main topic of tonight's teaching, which is meditation. This is a rather advanced topic in Buddhist teachings.
那么禅定啊是什么呢？什么叫做禅定呢？禅有很多种禅定啊。首先，我们大家都比较了解的，也就是通常禅就是指的是四禅八定。
So there are many different kinds of meditation techniques. One that we are probably all rather familiar with is the meditative absorptions of the eight dhanas.
四禅八定呢，不仅仅是佛教外道也修四禅八定，而且过去的外道像印度教这样子的这个宗教当中啊，有很多人是禅定的功夫相当高的，所以四禅八定不是佛教的特有的过去的很多的修行人都修四禅八定。
However, meditation on the eight meditative absorptions are not exclusive to the Buddhist tradition. In history, particularly in various Indian religious sects, the practice of the eight meditative absorptions was very popular, and in fact, some meditative practitioners from different sects achieved very high levels of meditative accomplishment.
那么这个禅定它有什么作用呢？就是它使我们的心平静下来那么为什么要我们的心要平静下来呢？最后 要真无空性，就像禅宗这样的明心见性啊，或者是大圆满、大收音啊这样子的空心，才真无这样子的空心，才能够解决我们的最后的这个问题。那么要真悟这样子的空心的话，首先我们的心要平静下来，在这个平静的状态当中，才有机会看到心的本性。
What kind of purpose does this kind of meditation achieve? What it enables us to do is to quieten our minds, calm our minds, and to use this as a basis for then realizing the nature of emptiness or achieving enlightenment as described in the Chan traditions or the Dzogchen or the Mahamudra traditions. In order for us to be able to realize the basic nature of the mind, it's necessary first that we are able to bring it into a calm state.
那么真无空性的这个方法此底就是有三种，大概就是有三种不同的真无空性的方法。
In terms of methods for attaining a realization of emptiness, there are approximately three different methods.
那么三种方法是什么呢？最简单的方法就是先宗的中观的这种方法。那么这个方法呢，通过逻辑推理，最后就是推出我们的心的本心是空性的然后通过这个理论感受到通过这个空性的时候，然后在这个基础上一步一步的修这个也是一种方法。
The first of these methods is a sutric method based on the Madhyamaka approach, and this involves us using logical reasoning to arrive at a conclusion of the empty nature of the mind, and on this basis to gradually develop an experiential realization.
另外一个方法呢，就像密宗里面讲的这个气脉明颠的修法就像十轮金刚或者是其他的密宗里面这个修的这个气脉明颠的这个修法。那么这个气脉明颠的修法呢，它的最终的目的就是要证悟空心。如果不能证悟空心的话，那么这个气脉明颠的修法跟外道的气脉明颠的修法是没有什么区别的。外道也有外道也有很多，尤其是这个印度教这样子古老的这些宗教里面呢，都有气脉明颠的修法。所以如果我们的气脉明颠的修法跟空心没有关系的话，那么这个也不是佛教的。
The second method available to us is to rely on Zalong practices. However, if the ultimate objective of our Zalong practice is not to obtain a realization of awareness, then in fact there is not much distinction between these practices and those that are practiced in other religious traditions as well. In fact, in the past, in ancient Indian traditions, Zalong practices were very widespread. So what distinguishes their use in a Buddhist context is their deployment towards the ultimate attainment of realization of emptiness.
然后最后一个方法，第三个方法真悟空性的方法，就是大圆满还有大收音还有这个禅宗他们的这种方法那么大圆满、大收音、禅宗尤其是大圆满跟这个禅宗他们第一个没有通过逻辑不需要太多的逻辑的思维然后呢，第二也不需要太多的这个气脉明颠的修法禅宗里面就没有气脉明颠的修法，大圆满里面呢也很少但是行静下来的时候呢， 就是直接可以感悟到心的本性啊，直接可以感受到感悟的心的本性。那么这个就是最上等的、最殊胜的啊，证悟空性的方法。
And the third set of methods that are available to us are the practices of the Dzogchen, Mahamudra, and Chan traditions. Particularly, the Dzogchen and Chan traditions don't rely on much logical reasoning. They don't rely or entail much Zalong practice. They essentially operate by enabling us on the foundation, with the foundation of a quiet, calm mind to directly perceive the basic nature of our mind.
那么这个时候的啊，这个时候的这个那证悟啊空性的方法呢，啊心平静啊，平静了以后，然后在这个平静的状态当中去感受。啊，自己的心的本心啊，如果心啊很平静，如果有这个禅定，这样子的话，在这个状态当中呢，比较这个证悟空心啊，看到心的本心的可能性是比较大。
In these practices, if we are able to have a mind that rests in a very calm and tranquil state, then it's easier for us to obtain realization of the basic nature of mind.
啊，但是这个啊，这三个不同的证悟空性的方法当中啊，第一个就是中观的啊证悟空性的方法，这个是我们每一个人都可以去修啊，大家都比较能够啊能够接受，也就是比较容易啊，就是先去逻辑推理。推理了以后呢，我们知道啊，比较清楚的感受到心的本心是空性的时候，就是保持啊这个感受啊，这就叫做这个空性的修法，所以比较简单的，所以这种证悟空性的方法呢，适合我们所有人。
The first of these three sets of methods.The first one that relies on the Sutric Madhyamaka approach is the most simple and the most accessible to all people. Essentially, we rely on logical reasoning, and when we obtain a realization or an experience of the nature of emptiness, then we seek to abide in this state.This is an approach that is probably well suited to everyone.
然后第二个修法就是通过七脉明点的修法去证悟空心、啊、这个方法呢、啊、就是比较精进的人比较勇猛的人适合修这个修法如果能够修的话那么他的证悟空心的这个速度呢、啊、比前面的会快一些但是啊，这个就只能一部分的人修，因为这个当中的很多的修法也是啊比较复杂的啊。另外一个呢，就是我们比较懒惰的、不太努力的人修这个，要成就的话也有一点难度。
The second type of practice that relies on the manipulation of Zalong is a practice that's only suited to a small number of people, those who are exceptionally diligent in their practice. The reason for this is that many of the practices are quite complex in nature, so it's not very suitable for those of us who tend to be more lazy or less diligent.
那第三个方法呢、啊、第三个方法是最殊胜了、啊、最殊胜、啊、是最好的这个、方法但是这个方法、啊、用这个方法的人、啊、或者是能够用这个方法适合这个方法的人呢就是根基、啊、必须要这个成熟、啊、山根很成熟的这个根基很成熟的人才可以修啊、比如说像禅宗的话那就是像六祖慧能大师这样子的人就非常非常容易的证非常容易证悟那么后来呢证悟的人就比较少。
The third set of practices are the most marvelous, they're the most extraordinary. However, people who are suited to engaging in these practices are those whose capacity and level is already very mature. These are relatively few people who fit this criteria. Examples would be Huineng and other masters like him.
那么近代的高僧啊，大家都公认的高僧徐云大师啊，徐云老和尚说，啊，中国禅宗啊最兴盛的时候就是唐朝的时候。唐朝的时候呢，有很多很多人就是依靠这个禅宗的修法啊，证悟了。
The acclaimed modern Chan master, Master Xunyun, once said that the most flourishing era of Chan practice was during the Tang Dynasty. And during this time, many, many practitioners achieved enlightenment through relying on Chan techniques.
然后宋朝以后呢，这个禅宗当中证悟的人也不是很多。不多的原因呢，就是因为大家这个对这个修心的投入可能不是那么到位，所以虚云大师就是说从宋朝以后呢依靠这个禅宗证悟的人不是很多。
But from the Song Dynasty, the number of practitioners who achieved enlightenment through relying on Chan practices began to decline, and Master Xun suggested that this was because from this time onwards, their practitioners or Buddhists in general were less invested in their practice.
禅宗就是我们认为禅宗就是大手印的一部分，大手印的一部分就是禅宗。它禅宗根本不是一个很简单的显宗的修法，它是一个大手印里面的一部分的修法。
In general, the Chan tradition shouldn't be regarded as just a simple sutric path. In fact, we generally regard the Chan teachings as part of the Mahamudra teaching.
藏传佛教的密法里面呢也有记载当初这个大寿音传入西藏的时候就有两种大寿音，一个是需要观钉的需要观钉的大寿音，另外一个呢不需要观钉的大寿音。这两个大寿音的传承马尔巴大师都有。马尔巴大师这两个传承都有，这是几百年前的人说的话。
The Vajrayana scriptures, in fact, record that when the Mahamudra teachings were transmitted to Tibet first through the translator Marpa, there were actually two lineages. One that did not require initiation in order to practice. So an exoteric practice and an esoteric practice as well, one that did require initiation in order to practice.
马尔巴大师虽然有这两个传承都有，但是呢，后来就是这个不需要观钉的这个大寿音呢，没有怎么去传，因为藏传佛教的这些所有的密法都是需要观钉的，所以呢。他们传的这个大寿音，也就是需要观钉的大寿音，没有不需要观钉的这个大寿音呢，后来就没有怎么传。
Even though the translator Marpa was in possession of both of these lineages, he didn't widely transmit the lineage or that did not require initiation. The reason for this was at that time.All Tibetan practices were essentially esoteric in nature, requiring initiations. And so for this reason, the lineage that he transmitted widely was the one that similarly required initiation.
那么这个马尔巴大师的这个传承当中的这个大不需要观钉的这个大寿音他的 依据啊，他的依据，他的依据的这个佛经啊，都是贤宗的啊，不是密法，都是贤宗啊。那么他为什么是密法的这个大修音呢？因为他的这个证悟的方式啊，跟其他的这个显宗的佛这个方法是不一样的。显宗的方法就是用逻辑推理，就是中观里面讲的这种方法，就是他的证悟的方法。但是禅宗他的证悟的方式呢不是这样子，他是直指人心啊，直接证悟，所以他跟其他的显宗是不一样的。但是他的依据这些佛经都是显宗的佛经。
So even though the sutric origins of the Mahamudra lineage that didn't require initiation were derived from the sutric tradition, the reason that we describe this approach or this lineage as essentially belonging to the Vajrayana tradition is because the means of attaining enlightenment that it entails is very different to the usual sutric approach. Rather than relying on logical reason or logical extrapolation, the Chan teachings point directly to the basic nature of the mind.
那么这个证悟空心的方法啊，方法呢，这个禅宗啊，或者是大圆满，它的证悟方法，证悟空心的方法就有两种，一个是先证悟，然后后修禅定啊，有这样子的，这个就是先证悟了啊，证悟了以后呢，就修这个他所证悟的境界，那么这个当中禅定也就自然而然就修成功了。这个叫做先证悟后修心。
So in terms of this third category of practices, there are essentially two types. One that involves first having an experience of enlightenment and after that engaging in meditation in order to make that realization abiding. This is referred to as the first achieve enlightenment and then meditate approach.
那么另外一个呢，就是先修禅然后再后证悟，这个是大多数都是这样子的大多数的这个佛教的方法都是这样子。
The other approach is to first engage in meditation and subsequently attain enlightenment, and the vast majority of Buddhist practices follow this order.
先证悟后修禅，或者是先修禅后证悟，这两个方法达摩祖师的这个禅祖师禅当中，这两个都有。
Both of these approaches, with their different orders, are contained in the writings of Bodhidharma.
在藏传佛教里面这两个都有，但是呢。比如说噶举派的大首音是先修禅后证悟是这样子，但是他也有先证悟后修禅，但是呢他的一般的他的方法，大多数的方法就是先修禅后证悟。
The Tibetan Vajrayana tradition containsbotheof these approaches. The Mahamudra tradition, for example, follows the approach where we first engage in meditative practice and then subsequently achieve enlightenment. These teachings do also contain teachings that have practices which follow the opposite order, but in general, they follow the approach where we first meditate and subsequently achieve an experience of enlightenment.
好，然后大圆满呢，先证悟后修禅。大圆满它的大多数的修法，它的主要的修法是这样子的：先证悟了证悟了以后呢。在证悟的境界当中就可以修除这个禅定也就是说 他证悟了以后就安住在这个证悟的状态当中，安住在证悟的状态当中，然后呢在这个证悟的状态，它本来就是一个非常平静的状态，这个里面呢已经包含了这个禅定，所以呢他不需要单独去修禅定啊，证悟的状态他就维持啊，能够维持证悟的状态，这里面已经有了禅定的这个结果啊，已经包含了禅定的结果，所以大圆满的主要的修法是先证悟后修禅。
The major approach of the Dzogchen teachings, however, is to first attain realization of emptiness, and from there to abide in meditative absorption. The reason for this is that the experience of the realization of emptiness is a very clear, very peaceful, tranquil state. It already contains the seeds, as it were, of meditative absorption, and so the practitioner rests in this state, abides in this state.
先证悟后修禅，就是像六祖慧能大师一样的。六祖慧能大师他证悟之前没有修什么禅，他证悟了，证悟了以后以后修行，所以呢先证悟后修行就是一个这样子的。
So this approach where the practitioner first attains a realization of emptiness and then cultivates meditative stability is the approach that the sixth patriarch Hui Neng practiced.
禅宗的这个证悟的方法啊，证悟的很多很多证悟的方法跟大圆满都是非常非常相似的啊。大圆满里面的这些这些过去的这些成就者啊，他们证悟的方法呢跟禅宗的证悟的方法也非常的相似的。
There are many similarities between the techniques that the Chan and Dzogchen teachings use for the achievement of enlightenment. There are many similarities in the ways that previous Chan masters and Dzogchen masters have achieved their awakening.
但是我们绝大多数的人来说最适合我们的这个路就是先修禅定然后把我们的心平静下来，然后呢这个做到了以后，修出来了以后呢，再去修空心，去修真悟这个是比较，就比较可靠的，也就是说，适合大多数人的一个方法。
However, the approach that is most suited to the greater majority of people is the one where we first cultivate meditative stability and on this basis achieve an realization of the nature of emptiness.
所以大圆满里面呢他也强调一般的人呢先去修禅然后再去证悟，所以大圆满就一般都是修禅定修两年左右然后再去修这个大圆满这样子的话就是比较容易证悟的。
So it's for this reason that the Dzogchen teachings usually emphasize the practice first of meditative stability and then going on to achieve a realization of emptiness.
因为我们大多数的人的根基没有那么好，所以我们一下子要去证悟的话，这个有相当大的难度。所以我们先修出离心，然后再修菩提心然后金刚萨埵的修法曼扎拉的修法等等，一步一步的修，把这些加心全部修完了以后，然后就是用一年到两年这样子的时间当中修禅定。
For the greater majority of people, however, our levels and capacities are really not ripe enough for us to achieve an instant realization of emptiness in this way. So this is why we start off by practicing the preliminaries, cultivating renunciation, cultivating bodhicitta, moving on to vajrasattva practice, the making of mandala offerings, etc. And through completing the preliminary practices, we then go on and cultivate our meditative stability for approximately 2 years.
这个原理是什么呢？就像水不是很急的时候呢，或者是一个湖水水不懂的时候，我们可以在这个水底下的一根草、木、石头等等，所有都看得很清楚的。 但是如果水流动的比较急的话，就是看不见这个水底下的东西，同样的，我们的心非常浮躁的时候，我们很难看到它的真相，就是心平静下来了以后呢，才能够看到它的真相。
It's like a river that is flowing very fast, or a lake that is very turbid. It's difficult for us to see the grass or stones or objects at the bottom of the riverbed. It's the same with our minds. When they're turbulent, when they're agitated, it's very difficult for us to see their basic nature.
所以我们今天讲这个禅定和真无，也就是概念性的给大家介绍一下而已，实际上具体的修法 我们现暂时还不讲，因为具体的修法，因为我们很多很多人还没有修无私家心，连我们私家心都没有修完。那么这个时候呢，这些都是基本上我们永不伤的，基本上都是永不伤的。所以呢，我们修心的时候呢，还是要根据这个实际情况，就把这个先是处理心，然后其他的这样子一步一步修。
So tonight we're going to give a conceptual introduction to meditation. It's not going to be a concrete introduction to meditation practice, the reason being that until everyone has completed the preliminary practices, then there is really not much point in learning the concrete practice details.
那这些禅修的方法在佛教里面用不同的这个俗语，用不同的语言来表达，就像南传佛教里面讲内观，那么南传佛教里面讲的内观禅修就是修这个，大部分都是修四禅八定，就是修禅，但是叫做内观。
Meditation practice in the southern tradition is referred to by the name of Vipassana.
然后呢，汉传佛教里面呢，很多地方都叫做四禅八定。
Whereas in Chinese Buddhism, meditation practice is, or meditation is often referred to as meditation on the eight dhanas.
藏传佛教里面呢，也叫四禅八定，但是很多时候就叫做极致的修法。
This is also the way that this meditation is described in the Tibetan tradition, but in general we call refer to it as shamatha.
那么南传佛教讲的内观，汉传佛教里面讲的四禅八定，藏传佛教讲的这个极致，实际上就是禅定，就是在讲这个禅定的部分，还不是真悟，不一定是真悟，就是在讲禅定的部分。
So the insight meditation that is described in the southern tradition, the meditation on the eight dhanas that is described in the, that is referred to in the Chinese tradition, and the shamatha meditation of the Tibetan tradition are referring to essentially a similar meditative practice, one that does not yet involve the meditation leading to a realization of the nature of emptiness.
然后这个禅定的方法、啊、这种禅定的修法呢，在藏传佛教的密法里面呢，特别特别的多，修行的方法非常的多，这个藏传佛教里面。
Within the Tibetan Vajrayana tradition, there are a wealth of meditation techniques.
那么这些方法、啊、都能够，如果我们自己能 修得好、啊做到位、啊、这样子的话呢这些禅修都能够、啊、都能够把让我们的心平静下来。
Any of these techniques practiced properly will enable us to achieve a calm state of mind.、
啊、我们简单的、啊、讲一个具体的修法、啊、有很多种这个修法当中呢就其中一个最简单最简单的一个修法、啊一个修法呢首先我们前几天讲过的比如说先这个做毗卢七法、啊、身体的姿势然后、啊、就是这个、排气、啊、然后观想、啊、这些一个一个都要去做。
So, we'll give an introduction tonight to one of the simplest of these techniques. This technique begins by adopting the seven meditation postures, expelling stale breath, and visualizing the Buddha in front of us.
这三个我们平时、打坐的时候都需要做，但是因为我们之前这个讲过很多次了，所以网上有、这个视频我们可以下载，所以我们今天、不重复。
These preparatory steps are ones we need to go through every time we engage in a session of meditation, but because we've talked about them a lot before and because there's clear instructions regarding how to put them into practice available online, I'm not going to go into them in any great depth this evening.
那么这个完了以后呢，我们比如说一个简单的方法，就是像一个释迦牟尼佛的佛像啊，唐卡这样的这个佛像啊，像唐卡呀，或者其他佛像也可以的，啊、一个释迦牟尼佛的佛像，或者是阿弥陀佛啊，或者是药师佛、观世音等等都可以的啊。这唐卡啊，就是。四个手指、啊、这么大的、啊、四寸、啊、或者是一咒、啊、从这个地方到这里叫一咒、啊、就有一咒这么高的这个唐卡、啊、开光、啊、开光了以后就是放在自己的前面。
So after we have completed these preparatory steps, we place an image of the Buddha, could be the Sakyamuni Buddha or Amitabha Buddha, either 4 inches in size or from 4 inches small to a size that is the half of one arm span. After this image has been properly consecrated, we place this in front of us.
然后我们就心平静下来两只眼睛就看这个佛像啊，先看佛像的这个眉间，两个眉毛之间啊，有一个拜垫，这个叫做拜毫啊，就是一种毫毛啊。但是这个跟身上的其他的毫毛不一样，这个佛的这个拜毫，如果拉可以拉长一肘两肘啊，啊放回来的时候呢。就像一个弹簧一样旋转的就在这个佛的游旋的、啊、就在这个佛的眉间、啊、那么我们在这个佛像上面看到的、啊、比如说唐卡、啊、上面看到的这个拜垫、啊、这个就是叫做拜毫、啊、所以我们两只眼睛就看着这个拜毫。
And we fix both of our eyes on the white ulna curl between the Buddha's eyebrows. This curl is one, when pulled out, when extended, can stretch as long as two half lengths of an arm. And yet when it is contracted, it just appears as a small dot between the brows of the Buddha.
然后心, 也就专注在这个佛的这个拜好, 意思就是说我们的心和两只眼睛, 就锁定在这个拜好, 这个上面, 然后一动不动, 心平静下来。
So we focus our eyes and we focus our mind on this spot, this point between the two brows of the eyebrows of the Buddha. And in so doing so, we rest our minds.
任何事情，也就是说，不要去思考过去的东西，也不要去思考未来的事情。当下的心就归零，归零是什么意思呢？零是什么？比如说一个数字从一从零，然后就一二三四五六七八，最后又归零。同样的，我们的心 是从阿赖耶识上面产生了意识，然后眼耳鼻舌身，在现实生活当中，他们去这个感受外在的这些外面的世界。然后呢，禅定的时候呢，都会归零，零就是我们的精神的最基本、最基本、最低层的。 最低的这个层面，用我们佛教的话来讲，就叫做阿赖耶识，要进入这个状态。
So while focusing single-pointedly on this point, we don't chase thoughts of the past and we don't follow thoughts of the future either. We bring our minds back to the most basic point of zero. All of our senses essentially emerged from our alaya consciousness. So when we are engaging in this meditation, what we are doing is bringing our mind back to its most restful, original, basic level.
通过这种方法, 然后我们的心就可以平静下来的, 但是具体的这个方法呢, 我们还要进一步的去学习，回灯之光里面有好几种这个禅修的方法，有一个叫做禅修的要诀，然后另外一个叫做挑心的过程，还有一个就是这个禅定的四个过程等等，就是这个里面呢，就整个的这个禅定的过程介绍的比较清楚的，这个有文字。 有这个视频都有的，大家可以通过这些进一步的去学习禅修的具体的方法。So
by relying on this technique, it's possible to bring our minds into a state of calmness. But as for further instructions, it's necessary that we study further for ourselves. And in the Wisdom Light book series, there are three chapters that deal with the different stages of meditation and how to go about meditation practice. These instructions are available in text and they're also available in video format.
然后心平静下来了以后，我们要去看这个心的本性，那么去看心的本性的时候，那么如果我们在这个之前的四加心、五加心都做得好，做得都做得比较到位，这样子的话，那么这个心非常平静的时候呢，有可能我们就证悟了自己的心的本性。
So it's on this, against or on this, upon this basis of a very calm state of mind that we apply ourselves to looking at the nature of the mind. If our preliminary practices have been completed to a high level, then it's possible by doing this that we will obtain a realization of the nature of our mind.
那心平静的时候，这个时候呢，有两个状态，一个状态就是我们刚刚讲到的这个，禅定啊，那这个禅定呢，也是没有杂念的，非常非常平静的啊，就是没有经验啊，没有修行的经验的人，很多人啊，把这个很平静的这个状态，就是误以为啊是啊这个正悟的境界，但是实际上正悟的境界跟这个两个啊有很不一，有相同的地方，但是呢也有很不一样的地方啊。但是我们用语言啊，我们用语言来表达的时候呢，很多很多都是相同的，这两个都是非常非常相同的，因为这个语言只能这么讲，所以两个都是很相同的。
At this point, there are two possible meditative states that we can experience. One of them is an extremely calm state of samadhi. It's a state where we don't have any disturbing thoughts at all. It's a very peaceful, quiet state. And some people, in fact, mistake this state for an experience of enlightenment. There are actually commonalities, shared aspects between the two states. But the fact that in language, our language is limited in its capacity to describe the difference between the states, and often when we use language to describe them, it really appears as if we're explaining one thing, but in actual fact, it isn't a state of a realization of emptiness.
那么第二个状态是什么呢？第二个状态就是真无的状态啊。我们刚才讲这个心平静的状态就有两种，一个是没有真无，但是呢心非常的平静啊，这个就是禅定啊，它的本质是什么呢？就是我们的心啊，我们的意识杂念回到阿赖耶识啊，实际上它就是阿赖耶识的状态。
So there are these two different states that we can attain. The first, as we've just said, is a state of extreme peace, extreme tranquility. It's a state of returning to our alaya consciousness, as it were, but it's not a state of enlightenment.
另外一个状态啊，就是同样的心非常的平静啊。但是呢，这个是不仅仅是平静，在平静的状态当中，真悟啊，它就是有真悟嘛，所以呢，它的状态不是阿赖耶识，而是智慧啊，而是智慧，就是证悟空性的智慧。这个时候呢，啊，它已经不是阿赖耶识的状态，它就是智慧的状态啊，这个叫做真悟。
The second state is one that is also entails a very calm mind. It's on the basis or on the foundation of a calm mind that we achieve an experience of enlightenment. And this is not a returning to the alaya consciousness. This is wisdom, the wisdom of having realized the nature of emptiness.
大圆满大收音的真悟是跟禅宗的真悟啊非常非常的相似，所以啊我们讲这个真悟的时候呢，我们用几个这个禅宗的话来给大家啊简单的介绍什么叫做真悟。
The enlightenment described by the Chan traditions and the Dzogchen and Mahamudra traditions are very similar. So in describing the state of enlightenment, I'm going to use several Chan expressions.
Chan 宗的禅有两种，一个叫做如来禅，另外一个叫做祖师禅。如来禅 是释迦牟尼佛传下来的这个禅修的方法啊，祖师传就是大摩祖师啊，大摩祖师的当然离不开释迦牟尼佛讲的这个法，但是呢稍微有一点点不一样，所以叫做祖师禅。禅就有两种禅。
There are two Chan lineages within the Chan teachings. One referred to as Rulai Chan, and this is a teaching lineage descended from the Buddha. The other is referred to as Zushi Chan, and this is descended from Bodhidharma. There are a few similarities and differences between the two, but this is how we distinguish them.
那么证悟空性的时候，证悟什么呢？达摩祖师的达摩无心论啊，有一个论叫做达摩无心论啊。达摩无心论是一个从文字的角度来讲，这是一个很小很小的论点，但是它的这个内容深到什么程度呢？就是跟大圆满跟这个大受印几乎是没有什么区别的，至少讲空性的这个角度来讲，根本就是分不清楚的。
Bodhidharma authored a text.
无心论，真无空性，真无本性，无心论。
Bodhidharma penned a text, a very small text on the attainment of realization.Even though it's a very small text with simple language, it is approximate to the Dzogchen teachings in terms of its content.
那么这里面就讲啊，达摩祖师讲，知心是空，名为见佛啊，就是这个八个字啊，知就是指导啊，指导或者是。正悟啊，这个地方讲的指导的知，当然不是从文字上、从理论上指导或者是理解啊，而是我以我们的心去感受啊，亲自去感受、感悟啊，这样子体会叫做知啊，不是文字上的知，不是理论上的指导和理解，而是直接。
This text contains a line regarding the attainment of enlightenment and realization of one's Buddha nature. The first character of this line is zhi, and it refers to knowing a direct perception, not an intellectual reasoning or any kind of other understanding of the mind, but rather a directunmediated perception.
知领悟，领悟体会啊，体会什么呢？体会心是空，我们自己的心啊，我们的内心啊是空啊，就像这个我们面前的虚空一样啊，空性啊，身体会到啊，心的本心是空心啊。那么这个叫什么名字呢？就叫做名为见佛啊，这就叫做见到了佛啊，这样子。名为见佛，这开始跟你问你学习的人，名为见佛就是他的名字就叫做见到佛啊。这个我们刚才这个的经解啊，刚才讲的这个心啊。知道空心他叫什么名字呢？他叫做见到佛，看见释迦牟尼佛，很简单。
Okay, so the realization of emptiness is also referred to as seeing or beholding the Buddha.
这个就是《金刚经》里面讲的我们不要以为释迦牟尼的身体是佛，这个不是佛，真正的佛是。不是用眼睛来看，又不是用耳朵来听，真正的佛它不是物质金刚经讲得很清楚，那是什么呢？ 这是我们的心的本心啊，这叫做佛。
This is something that the Diamond Sutra also elaborated on. The Buddha is not something that we tangibly perceive with our eyes or with our ears. The Buddha is not a material form. Rather, the Buddha is the basic nature of our minds.
我们虽然说我们没有福报亲眼见到释迦牟尼佛，释迦牟尼佛是2500多年前的那些人可以见到佛，我们没有福报看见佛但是实际上2500多年前当时的人看到的释迦牟尼佛其实不是佛，这个就是佛的形象还不是真佛。
Even though we often talk about ourselves not having the good karma to have beheld the historical Buddha with our own eyes 2,500 years ago, in actual fact, those who were there at that time and did see the Buddha were not actually seeing the Buddha. They were simply seeing the image of the Buddha.
那么真正的佛呢，我们也有机会见到佛，而且我们如果能够见到这种佛的话，那么这个就不是佛的心相，而是佛的本体佛的本体。所以我们如果能够证悟到自己的心的本性的话，那么这个就叫做见佛，见到佛，我们看见佛了看见什么佛呢？我们看见的就是佛的发身不是佛的化身就是佛的发身。
We too have an opportunity of beholding the Buddha. The Buddha is not the external form of the Buddha, but if we realize the nature of our own minds, then we are realizing the essence of the Buddha, the Dharmakaya, rather than the emanation body.
这个非常非常重要的非常的重要的。如果我们今天去听大圆满听大手印，那么它的见解上面呢讲我们听到的就是这些就是这些文字，就是这些文字了但是它的方法就有可能有一点点不一样，通过一个稍微不一样的方法让我们这个体会到这一点这是方法上的不一样而已，境界上它所表达的内容完全是一样的禅宗讲的跟大手印讲的是一样的。
So this state that is being described is common to the Chan tradition and the Dzogchen teachings and the Mahamudra teachings, even though the technique that the different traditions may expound in order to have us arrive at this realization, the state of realization that they are describing is ultimately the same.
这个主要是般若波罗蜜多空心，就像心经金刚经这样子的这个空心的中观的思想，也就是释迦牟尼佛在一生当中转了三次法轮的第二次法轮的思想就是刚才讲的八个字。
So these eight words from Bodhidharma's text refer to the realization of emptiness in the Madhyamaka teachings and the description of emptiness described in sutras like the Diamond Sutra and the Heart Sutra.
好，还有一个非常有意思的这个几句话我们来学习一下然后又是同样是大摩无心论里面讲立性无佛，立佛无心，就是说离开了我们的心以后有没有佛呢就是没有佛如果离开了这个佛以后呢，有没有我们的心呢？没有心，意思就是说除了我们的心以外没有佛，除了佛以外没有我们的心心就是佛，佛就是心意思就是这样子。
There's also another extraordinary line from Bodhidharma's work, and it is that there is no mind beyond the Buddha and no Buddha beyond the mind. This line refers to the fact that except for the Buddha or beyond the Buddha, there is no other mind that we can speak of. And similarly, aside from our own minds, then there is no other Buddha.
那我们很多人就有这样子的疑问，如果我们的心就是佛，那么我比如说我佛除了佛以外没有我们的心，我们的心以外没有佛，那么是不是佛也有贪嗔痴，是不是？那如果我们的心就是佛，那我们为什么还要学佛呢？我们不就已经是佛了吗？有这样子的疑问，但是这个问题 怎么解释呢？这里讲的心就是佛的意思，就是说如果我们证悟的话，当下我们就会发现，其实我们的心本来就是佛，并不是说我们把一个不是佛的心修了很长时间以后把它转变为佛。不是这样子，它本来就是佛，但是呢，以前我根本不知道它是佛，所以我这个时候呢，这叫做迷的时候，我不知道它是佛，但是现在悟的时候呢，也不是我的心变成了佛，而是我发现它本来就是佛，这样子。
Many people may be confused here, thinking, how can it be that my mind is the Buddha when I have all kinds of defilements and obscurations? And in fact, my mind is already Buddha, then why is it necessary for me even to study Buddhism? But this kind of understanding is a misunderstanding. What this line is referring to is that in the moment that we experience a realization of the nature of emptiness, then we will realize at this very instant that our mind is the Buddha and that the Buddha is our mind. In saying this, what is happening here is not a transformation from a mind that was originally something else through gradual practice into a Buddha. It's referring to the fact that our original state, the original state of our mind, is something that when we are in a state of confusion, we are unable to perceive, we're unable to apprehend. But when we are enlightened, we can see it for its natural state, and that is, we can see its Buddha nature.
然后大摩祖师用一个比喻来进一步的说明这个问题。然后他说，刚才我们上面讲到，我们的心和这个佛是一体，现在就讲 众生与菩提，众生就是我们众生，大家都知道，菩提是什么？菩提就是佛，有些时候叫做佛，有些时候叫做涅槃，有些时候呢就叫做菩提，那么这些都是梵文的一些词，都是意思呢都是觉悟者，就是佛，就是佛的意思。 所以，然后就说，这个众生与佛，一如冰与水，冰和水一样的，水零度以下的时候呢，就是变成了冰，液体在零度以下的时候就变成了一个固体的状态，然后。这时候呢，水已经变成了这个冰，一如冰之于水，为散冻所冻，就是说腊月或者是冬天的三个月的时候，水 就是变成了这个冰冻的固体的冻，即冰为冰，这个时候水 啊，冬天的三个月的时候，水变成了固体，叫做啊冰啊，这个就叫做冰。
There is a further line in Bodhidharma's work which likens the relationship between the mind and the Buddha to the relationship between water and ice. Water is something that below zero becomes a frozen solid and above zero becomes a liquid. The line in Bodhidharma's work says that water is something that during the 3 months of winter takes the form of ice.
然后就说为上下缩小即名为水啊，三个月的夏天啊，这个冰就是融化了啊，融化的时候呢就叫做水啊，这名字叫做水。
And during the 3 months of summer, the ice melts, and that which was previously known as ice is now known as water.
然后就进一步的说，若摄取冰，即无别睡。如果我们把这个冰抛弃了，摄取了那么有没有睡呢？没有水，水跟这个冰的本质是一体的，所以我们把这个水抛去了以后呢，没有冰。
This section goes on to say that if we were to questions whether if we were to get rid of ice, would we still have water? But the answer is no. Essentially, aside from the ice, there is no other water. In essence, they are the same.
对，然后说若弃却众生，则无别菩提，则无别菩提啊。如果我们抛弃了众生啊，那么除了众生以外，有没有佛呢？没有佛啊，众生的本心就是佛。
In a similar way, if we were to get rid of sentient beings, would we be left with the Buddha?And the answer to this is no, too. In fact, living beings are the Buddha. Without living beings, there is no Buddha.
明知病心即是水心啊，水心即是病心啊，水的本心啊就是病的本心啊，病的本心也就是水的病这个本心，本心上啊，水跟这个病啊是没有。区别的本质上是没有区别，但是它的一个物体的一个不同的心识而已，就是因为就为什么有不同的心识呢？就是这个不是它本质上的变化，而是外在的这个条件温度临上的时候就是水临下的时候就是冰，但是呢这两个的本质永远都是一体没有本质上没有区别。
So the essence of water and the basic essence of ice are exactly the same. It's not in terms of their basic essence that they differ. The way that they differ is in terms of the external form that they take. And this is something that is...that relies on or is a result of the circumstances or conditions in the external environment. So below zero, water becomes ice. Above zero, it takes the form of a liquid. Ultimately, though, in terms of their basic nature, water and liquid water and solid ice are both the same.
众生性质即菩提心也。众生与菩提同一心。最终的结论就是这个众生我们这个我们凡夫的本心就是佛心佛的本心然后佛的本心也就是众生的本心，这两个是本质上是没有区别的佛和众生是没有区别那么这句话我们怎么理解呢就是刚才讲的，当我们还没有真悟的时候呢，佛和众生是有区别的除了佛以外，有没有众生？有，我们就是 啊，然后除了众生以外，有没有佛？有佛，释迦牟尼佛啊。所以，当我们还没有证悟的时候呢，众生不是佛，佛也不是众生啊。但是这个时候，它本质上不是这样，只是我们认为是这样子啊，我们以为是这样子。从我们的观点讲啊，佛和众生啊是两回事啊。但是这个是我们啊还没有了解本心的时候啊的观点。
The ultimate conclusion of this section is that just like the basic essence of water, liquid water and ice are the same, so too is the basic essence of the Buddha and living beings, sentient beings. The fundamental nature or the basic nature of living beings is Buddha nature, and Buddha, the basis of Buddha nature is the same for living beings and the Buddha alike. However, in terms of understanding this from an unenlightened perspective, there is a difference between the Buddha and a sentient being, an ordinary person. While we are in an unenlightened state, then there, in addition to us as ordinary beings, there's a Buddha. The Buddha is separate, and we exist as in a dualistic relationship.
啊，那什么时候这个众生即是佛，佛即是众生呢？就是当我们证悟的时候啊，当我们证悟的时候，我们就会发现啊，原来啊，我们的本性就是佛啊，佛就是我们的心的本性。除了我们的心的本性以外，没有佛；除了我们的心的本性以外的佛，都是佛的心相。啊，不是佛的本体，佛的本体就是佛的化身，佛的化身就是我们的心的本性如来藏啊。这个时候就会，啊，会自己会发现啊，证悟的当下就会啊，就会感觉到啊，心的本性就是佛心啊。这样子，从证悟的人的角度来讲啊，这个佛心和众生啊，佛和众生啊。本质上就是一体啊，证悟的人的角度来讲就是这样子。那么证悟的人啊，所发现的就是应该是真理啊，所以呢，实际上佛就是众生啊，众生就是佛。
However, at the point of enlightenment, we realize in fact that the basic nature of our mind is in fact Buddha nature.That our basic nature is the nature of the Buddha, and that there is no separation or distinction between them. Every other Buddha, any other Buddha aside from the basic nature of our mind, is in fact not the Buddha, it's just an external manifestation of the Buddha or an external image of the Buddha. From the point of view of the enlightened perspective, the basic nature of one's own mind is Buddha nature. And since the enlightened state of mind or the enlightened state of knowledge is in fact true knowledge, then we can know there's no distinction between ourselves and the Buddha. There's no distinction between sentient beings and the Buddha.
啊，我们现在还没有证悟的时候所了解到的心啊，实际上就是我们的心的表面的现象啊，我们根本就还没有看到啊它的这个深处，也就是它的这个本质。我们看到的就是在我们现实生活当中啊，这个所接触到的、所感受到的。啊，这个各种各样的这些情绪，各种各样的念头啊，都不是它的本质，这就是一个它的表面的现象而已。
Until we are enlightened, that which we understand or perceive of our minds is not in fact its deepest, truest nature. That which we tend to observe and experience is simply its the superficial manifestations of our mind.Our thoughts, discursive thoughts of various nature, our moods, our feelings, etc.
那么我们什么时候能够啊了解到我们自己的心的本性呢？就是我们证悟的时候啊，就像禅宗讲的 这个明心见性啊，大圆满讲的真无空性，这个时候我们才啊，才这个真正的接触到了我们的自己的心的本心，或者它的本质。
It's only when we attain enlightenment that we're in actual fact able to understand the basic nature or the basic essence of our minds. It's only when we realize the nature of our mind or realize the nature of emptiness, that we are able to have this insight into the basic nature.
但是我们的心的本心啊是这样子，那么这个怎么样去修呢？啊，具体的方法是什么呢？比如说密宗里面啊，它允许我们把我们自己的身体观想为释迦牟尼佛啊，观想为阿弥陀佛，观想为啊金刚萨埵啊，这样子啊。那么我们从一般的这个佛教的观点来看的话，这个是不合理的。为什么呢？我们是有罪业的众生啊，金刚萨埵就是我们向他忏悔啊，才是对的啊！金刚萨埵就是佛，我们怎么可以把我们自己观想为金刚萨埵呢？啊，等等，很多时候啊，密法里面呢，我们把自己观想为这个啊本尊，那么这些的这个观点啊，简洁是什么呢？就是这个意思啊。显宗里面呢，就像禅宗，也就只讲我们的心的本心是啊佛心啊，然后就去从真无空性的角度去了解去修，但是实际修的时候呢，像比如说我们把自己观想啊本尊啊等等，禅宗里面也不提供这样子的修法。
In terms of practices that enable us to arrive at this kind of realization, the tantric tradition permits us to visualize ourselves in the form of a deity. We are able to visualize ourselves as the Buddha, we're able to visualize ourselves as Amitabha Buddha, as Vajrasattva, etc. Now, from the point of view of the sutric tradition, this is unreasonable. It's unreasonable because we are, at this stage, a being that is afflicted or that is in possession of karmic defilements. However, the view, in fact, that this kind of visualization is grounded in is precisely that in the text tonight, that we are ultimately, in our basic nature, inseparable from the Buddha.
啊，那么我们为什么要真无空心呢？真无心的本心呢？就是因为我们的所有的烦恼啊，所有的烦恼，就是因为我们不真无啊，没有真无空心，所以我们就有这么多的这个啊烦恼。这些烦恼的来源啊，就是我执啊，然后我执呢？我们就是因为没有证悟空心，所以我们有我执。如果证悟了空心，那么就立即就可以解决我执啊啊，可以推翻啊我执，可以断除我执。然后断除我执以后呢，所有的烦恼啊都可以断除的。
Why is it important for us to realize the basic nature of our minds, or why is it important for us to realize the nature of emptiness?The reason is that all of our sufferings, all of our problems derive from the fact that we don't understand the basic nature of our minds. And for this reason, we experience great self-clinging, which is the source of all our problems. However, by realizing the basic nature of our mind, then our self-clinging automatically dissolves.
我们每一个人都有真无空心的机会，我们每一个人也有这个升起处理心啊，修出这个菩提心啊，这些机会都有啊，也有真无空心的这个机会。所以呢啊，大家啊努力投入这个文思修行当中，争取啊我们死之前啊有处理心，有菩提心，真无空心。
Just as everyone has the opportunity in this lifetime to cultivate renunciation, to cultivate bodhicitta, everyone also has the opportunity to realize emptiness. So this is something that I'd urge everybody to really work hard on the study and practice, on one's study and practice, so that before the end of this lifetime, we have all realized the basic nature of our minds.
有这么好的机会，但是呢，我们不学习，我们就一直都停留在这个烧香拜佛的这个阶段，然后不去学习，不去打坐，一直都我们以为这个烧香拜佛就是学佛，然后就是我们请释迦牟尼佛来给我。 前处一些文愿，给我创造一些条件，生活上的条件，一直都以为这就是学佛啊，这样子的话，那这是非常非常可惜的。所以大家就从现在就开始这个深入的去了解佛法的真正的意思啊。然后呢，我们每天至少也有半个小时、一个小时这样子的时间集出来。 然后在这个时间当中就是修一下这个佛教的这些核心的，就像出离心、菩提心，尤其是证悟空心，这样子的话，才叫做真正的学佛。So
even though we have this wonderful opportunity in this lifetime, or since we have this wonderful opportunity to simply stay at the level of making incense offerings and thinks this is what the study of Buddhism about is a great pity indeed. So we should really do our best to allocate at least an hour of practice each day to the true study and practice of Buddhism.
因为我们这次的条件不是很差，所以只要我们自己如果能够努力的话，那么我们每个人都可以真悟的。希望大家努力，好，我们大家一起回向。说那么的一当这是把那多年你别的那半学家这个那句话弄这么这边做连着啊做玩儿秀。 我们阿訇班子仁格日巴玛色德訇，我们阿訇班子仁格日巴玛色德訇，我们阿訇班子仁格日巴玛色德訇。 谢谢大家，阿弥陀佛。